Today's scripture is taken from Acts chapter 20, verse 7 to 12, Titus chapter 2, verse 1 to 8, and 11 to 14. On the first day of the week, when we were gathered together to break bread, Paul talked with them, intending to depart on the next day, and he prolonged his speech until midnight. There were many lamps in the upper room where we were gathered, and a young man named Eutychus, sitting at the window, sank into a deep sleep as Paul talked still longer. And being overcome by sleep, he fell down from the third story and was taken up dead. But Paul went down and bent over him, and taking him in his arms, said, "Do not be alarmed, for his life is in him." When Paul had gone up and had broken bread and eaten, he conversed with them a long while, until daybreak, and so departed. And they took the youth away alive, and were not a little comforted. But as for you, teach what accords with sound doctrine. Older men are to be sober-minded, dignified, self-controlled, sound in faith, in love, and in steadfastness. Older women, likewise, are to be reverent in behavior, not slanderers or slave to much wine. They are to teach what is good, and so to train the younger women to love their husband and children, to be self-controlled, pure, working at home, kind, and submissive to their own husbands, that the word of God may not be reviled. Likewise, urge the younger man to be self-controlled. Show yourself in all respects to be a model of good works. And in your teaching, show integrity, dignity, and in sound speech that cannot be condemned, so that an opponent may be put to shame, having nothing evil to say about us. For the grace of God has appeared, bringing salvation for all people, training us to renounce ungodliness and worldly passion, and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly life in the present age, waiting for our blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us to redeem us from all lawlessness and to purify for himself a people for his own possession who are zealous for good works. This is the word of God.
Good morning, brothers and sisters in Christ. Today we have the privilege of having Brother Jonathan Yeo to share God's word with us. And we also are very glad to have his wife with us this morning, Lan Xiang. I think she's at the back or she's outside somewhere. She's at the back there. Okay, we welcome them. And actually, Brother Jonathan Yeo, he came to our church to preach before, I think, in 2019. And then he also conducted a VBS for children. So that was before the pandemic. For those of you who are not familiar with him, let me take some time to introduce him to you again. He was a science graduate with majors in chemistry and biology. And in terms of his ministry, he had been involved in campus and youth ministry for about 12 years and in children ministry for more than 31 years, including 11 years as full-time children pastor at DUMC. And he had completed a master in ministry and master in divinity from local seminaries. And he also has taught children ministry module at Malaysia Bible Seminary and Khao Tu Lay Karen Baptist Bible School in Thailand. And he has ministered at camps and churches locally and in the ASEAN region. Although retired as children pastor at UMC together with his wife, he continues to minister as itinerant preachers, trainer in children and family ministry, preaching, teaching, and training in local churches, and he and his wife has two grown-up children. So without further ado, we welcome Brother Jonathan for sharing God's word with us. Thank you.
Good morning, church. It's been a long time, right? The pandemic has left us out in the cold for a while, but we have nevertheless been keeping warm in the ministry. And indeed, the pandemic gave us a time for us to relook at how ministry was done. And I thank God that during the pandemic, throughout the pandemic, our children ministry continued to grow. Back in DUMC, we were reaching children really across the physical borders. We had children who comes into our Zoom classes, whenever we hold it on Zoom during the pandemic years. And these were children who were coming from across, not only across the states, but also from beyond the shores of this country, you know, from as far south as Australia, New Zealand, and and also in the east, from countries that are normally inaccessible, like Brunei. They were logging into the ministry program that we had. All right, so some of you who do not know, right, this picture is evidence that I'm a husband of only one wife, right, and I'm the father of one daughter and the father of one son. All right, so it's all 1-1-1, right? I was a practicing chemist in the chemical industry for 27 plus years, up to a point of covering the Asia Pacific region as the technical commercial manager for the likes of multinationals like ICI and all. Various kind of applications, mostly primarily dealing, for those who know chemistry, dealing with the related fields of oleochemical derivatives and its application in the industry. All right. So much about me. My wife was a teacher before she retired. I hope this works. Okay. All right. So since retiring, you must be wondering, what have I been doing? I've not been sitting at home waiting for my children to get married and have grandchildren. How do I operate this? All right. Okay, I'm also now a part of this team called Missionary Ventures International, MVI.org, if you can Google it up, from the US. you see the name Director Malaysia there. Actually, it's only in name lah, right? No. This is kerja tanpa gaji, all right? They don't pay me a salary. I don't get a salary from them. I basically raise my own funds working in the missions field. Right now, as an itinerant minister, I go wherever I'm invited to preach. So the main thing is I work with church planters. I work with people who are planting churches, who needs help, who need assistance, training, partnering with them, and also trying to inspire people from local churches wherever I go to preach to come alongside with me and go on short-term mission trip. You know, there are people who are interested to go on short-term mission trip, you know, because they still have their calling in the marketplace. That's fine, that's great, right? Come join me, right? Talk to me, right? And I will arrange for you to go out to minister on short-term basis, you know, whether it's for 3-4 days or it's for a week or over a weekend, to work with church planters across these nations, both in Malaysia as well as in the surrounding ASEAN nation. All right? So that's what I'm doing. And on top of that, I have not finished with my education. You say, "Ayo, uncle, you're so old already, oh. Still want to study, ah?" Right? Yes, I'm pursuing my doctoral studies in children and family development at the moment, right? Because this would then further equip me to not only train or teach in seminaries, but also in churches where I go to that ministers, all right? So on top of that, right, you will see I've got a lot of resources I brought with me. I also help to promote literature from our daily bread, right? You probably mean know daily bread only as devotional booklets, but today I bring with me many resources. Why we have got, you know, it's for every generation that's seated here, right? You know, you say daily bread only for young people. No, right? Uncle, auntie, I got resource today for senior people in our congregation. Then the youth say, ayo, only for all the uncle, auntie, nothing for me. God, dude, you want to know more about God? You want to build your faith? Can I really trust the Bible? I brought with me, right? You can pick that up from the table after this, right? And then parents, I see some young parents here. You say, so I got a lot of challenges. How do I help my children? Well, I did bring some resources for you parents, right? Help. I'm so stressed out about my children's education. What to do, right? Help. How to talk to my child? They're asking me about question about love, marriage. How to talk to them, right? I got good news for you parents. Today, I brought with me resources. Yeah? Then I believe some ladies would love this, right? Building blocks for a strong marriage, right? You can pick this up and start doing a couple's Bible study together at home, right? Yeah, husband and wife, work through this. As you work through the scriptures, you begin to understand what's God's original intent and design for marriages, all right? So this morning, right, the title of my sermon is Help! I have an alien in my home, all right? Yeah, I have an alien in my house, right? Help, what do I do? What do I do? What's that alien doing in your house? You might be wondering, right? It's a question that a lot of parents, right, will be tearing their hair out, right? Who is this alien in my home, right? Yeah? So, wow. You say, wow, Pastor, early morning, you show food already. How? What is this? What is this picture? Can somebody tell me? What is this picture? I give you a hint, all right? It's not my favorite food, but I do not mind eating it, right? But to all of you locals here, you probably will find this a very familiar dish in your home, right? Yeah? This is your famous signature dish, right? The hot or the sweet and sour fish maw soup, right? You call honru, right? Those who are Fuchao, have I got the pronunciation correct? I'm not Fuchao, sorry. So please excuse me, right? It's your signature, right? I believe in every one of these people who are Fuchao people, it's your signature dish, right? Probably you might cook it on special occasions and all, right? But what's so special about this dish that you're talking about? You say, well, Pastor, why? Today's sermon, you say alien, then you say this dish. Is this only food for aliens? What do you find inside this soup that makes it that signature dish that you call by that name? What must be present inside there? Fish maw, right? Isn't it? If I were to replace it with fried pork skin, you say, no, that's not true. That's not real, right? Yeah? What else would need to be in there? Mushrooms, right? Yeah? And you can choose what kind of mushroom you want to put inside there. And you probably need to have some meat in there, right? Yeah? Right? And you need to have some tomatoes in there and some lime juice or vinegar to make it taste a little bit sour. Am I correct? Right? I'm not really a master chef, by the way. I'm a foodie. My wife says, you know, you see food, you eat. That's all. Yeah? You don't know how to cook. Right? But for those who know how to cook, you know that you need to have some essential ingredients in there before you can call it this particular dish, right? It would be different if you were to discard with some of these key ingredients, or if you were to replace it with something else. Am I correct? If you were to take the fish maw out from it, it would no longer be this soup anymore, right? If you were to take, say, something like the fish maw, the mushrooms out from it, it will be a different soup altogether. You take away the vinegar, it will be a different soup altogether. You need all of this to be present in order for it to be known as that signature dish. So parenting sometimes is like that, right? You got the hot in the home, you got the sweet occasions, you got the sour occasions, but you really need it all. Right? It's a home. It's a home that you will look forward to come back to. It's a home, right? That, you know, but it says, now I got a youth in my home, a teenager. Every day I'm losing hair. You tell them, no, every day I'm losing hair. And the kid will just, in all the wisdom of ages, says, Mommy, because you use MSG la. Very wise. The abnormality in our midst, right, sometimes seems to be the norm in a home with teens, right? So what's the big idea today? The big idea that I have here is called Carpe Diem. It's not Cafe Tien, all right? It's Carpe Diem, right? Okay? Carpe Diem, seize the day, for this is the age of opportunity. Seize the day. Why is it called the day of opportunity? Right? We heard the scriptures just now being read about the story of Eutychus. You say, what's this story, you know, that you're talking this morning about this person called Eutychus? Right? Oh, he was a youth. So? He was a youth who, in the midst of all the preaching of Paul, he fell asleep. Wow. Everybody turn to the person on your right and your left. Please don't sleep this morning, huh? Right. So what? Okay. To the youth, today is Youth Sunday. I give you express permission to close your eyes but open your ears, all right? Yeah, I'm going to say something to the parents today, but it doesn't mean that this message is also not for you, right? And you can fall asleep like Eutychus. You fall asleep today, if you fell down, sorry, I'll ask Pastor Lester to go on top of you, right? I will be too busy up here to go down, right? And fall on you like Paul did. What's the story about this young man, right? This young man was really young, and scholars say that he was probably between the ages of 8 to 14. So he's a youth, right? He's a youth. He qualifies as a youth. And you know, amazingly, Luke was very, very detailed in his narrative. He wrote about that this Paul went on and on in his preaching, and the whole place, they had lamps, right? Now, they didn't have LED lights or lights like this. They had lamps, oil lamps. Now, can you imagine? The place was so packed. Oil lamps all over the place to brighten up. The smell of the burning oil, the stuffiness in it, right? Don't say the youth. You know, some of us old people will also fall asleep, right? But this particular incident, Eutychus fell from the balcony, and the scripture say that he died. And Paul got up, went down, prayed over him, and he came back to life. What has this got to do with the message today of an alien in our midst? What is youth? How do you define, apart from the chronological age? Yeah, the youth. The concept of youth was actually non-existent until post-World War II. And post-World War II, when the soldiers returned from the front lines, they begin to settle down and they begin to have families. You know, By the time industrialization hit the world in the 1930s, 50% of the people were already who are said to be between the ages of 14 to 17 were already in the working industrial world. The other 50%, this is the statistics from US, they were still in school. Now, what does the Old Testament have to say about this? Well, in the Old Testament, there really was no so-called child, youth, adults. There was only child, adults. By the time you turn 12, you probably be working out in the fields with your parents. That was what it was like in an agricultural society in the Old Testament. There was only children and adults. Wow. Some parents are secretly rejoicing. Now, today, after pastor's sermon, I can go back and tell my child, tomorrow you get to work. Huh? Tomorrow you get out in the morning, you follow me to work. Well, is that the case? In 1950s, right, came the day the youth generation was born. Why? As these people returned from the war and began to raise families, right, that the economy began to boom and marketers jumped on the bandwagon because they saw an opportunity for clothing that was meeting this particular target age groups. They saw there was products, consumer products that was needed for this particular age group. So the media and marketing gave birth to this cohort generation called the youth generation. A new subculture was born. So you find that today, the youth will be somewhere between 12 to the 18 years old, right? Yeah. In case you are trying to take down notes and taking photographs of the slides, no worry. Before I leave, by this afternoon, you probably can get the slides. I will leave the slides with your church office, right? You can always download a copy of them. So it appears that this youth culture, right, was the birth of marketeers and the media, and it is on even up to today that we see, right? So today we hear about names like Black Lives Matter, woke. We hear about cancel culture and all. Where did all these cultures birth? These cultures were birthed by the development, the evolvement of media and marketing. Very, very clearly, they are the so-called products of marketeers. And this has a very direct influence on the children that we have today. Today, the dysfunctionality that we see, right, in the ability to relate between the youth and the parents, the dysfunctionality in the way they communicate with their parents, all these are born through the influence of this culture values that are propagated through the media and marketing targeted at this. I'm sure that in our midst, some of you will have grown up the likes of Elvis Presley, right? How many of you knows Elvis Presley? Can I see by show of hands? It's okay. No worry. I'm not asking you to confess of your sin, right? Yeah, we all know about Elvis Presley. Elvis Presley came into the consumer world, in the world of pop music, in the world of rock and roll. It's also driven by this birth of this culture that the media, the marketers had very cleverly tapped on as a business opportunity. But before we delve further into how then do you parent a teenager, I'd like to share with you some basic, very fundamental truth that you must never forget as parents in raising up your children. Yeah, before we look into this, number one, always, always, no matter how difficult a situation you're in, no matter how challenging the situation is, remember, the children are not liabilities. They are the gift from God. Children are a gift from God. Psalm 127, verse 3 to 5 says, children are a heritage from the Lord. Offspring, a reward from Him. Like arrows in the hands of a warrior are children born in one's youth. Blessed is the man whose quiver is full of them. They will not be put to shame when they contend with their opponents in court. So children are a gift. They are not liabilities. They are not obstacles that we can put aside like we put aside a chair when we have no need for it. Yeah? No matter how upset you can be, right, they are still God's gifts for you. And they remain God's gift for you throughout their teenage years, even until their adulthood. Let me tell you this. I never knew this in so much clarity and convincingly than when God spoke to me about my firstborn. My firstborn child was born with autism. In those days, not even our specialists at KLGH could even diagnose. But we knew something wasn't right with the child. And so we had to search on the internet. Internet was very, very new that time, you know. In order to get on the internet, right, those of you who live in the 90s, right, you will have remembered the characteristic ring. That sort of modem sound, right? When you log on to the internet. Yeah? And we searched for information. We knew something was different. And times I was frustrated myself too. What to do with this child? Unknowingly, one night, in one of my business trips, I was in another country, and the Lord woke me up one night from my sleep and asked me of this one question. Do you believe a father would want to give the best gift to their children? I said, yes, Lord. I do believe a father would want to give the best gift. And the Lord says, do you believe that I would want to give you the best gift? I said, yes, Lord. I believe. And the next question really stunned me. Lord says, why then do you reject this child that I've given you? I said, God, my goodness, have I. And it dawned on me that in one of my frustrating conversation with my wife, she had said this. She said, you may say you accept, but in your heart, you cannot accept the reality that your child is different. I broke down. I got on my knees. And the Lord said something to me next that really shook me up that night and caused me to really repent. The Lord says, if you do not want this gift, I will take him home with me tonight because he belongs to me. I had to confess. I said, Lord, I'm sorry. I didn't realize. Teach me to be a steward, to raise this child as you intended. The day when I prayed that prayer and says, Lord, I believe and I accept this child, no matter. There was the breakthrough that I needed to get through to my son. You know, now that he's grown up, and I give glory to God as well as credit to my wife for all the patient years that she had walked with him. And Because my job then takes me on the road about 2 to 3 weeks in a month. I usually fly out on a Sunday evening or Monday morning, and I don't come back until Friday night, or fly back early Saturday morning, right? Then go on to church and then off again. You know, it's like for more than 10 years, I was like living out on a suitcase, you know, coming home on the weekends and all. And my wife really was the one who was instrumental to walk with him. But today, now that he's grown up, right, I thank God for how he has grown to be a child with a heart of compassion for those who have got a need around him. You know, we used to joke between us. I said, son, when you were young, you drive me up the wall, you know. Then he said, yeah, that now that I'm older, I drive you to church, you know. So sometimes he accompanies me on my preaching engagement. He would drive me to the the churches in Klang Valley whenever I have a preaching engagement. But what I want to say is that this lesson taught me that every child, no matter who or how he or she is, there are a gift from God. 2, parenting a teen is never easy. Who says it's easy? Right? If you tell me that it's easy, you don't have problems, then I think you have problems. You are just not facing reality and accepting reality. Right? Yeah? But you have different kind of challenges, right? They are unique. Right? And this is, like I say, the age of opportunity. The opportunity, what kind of opportunity does it present in this time and age? Is that opportunity for you to shape a young mind, for you to shape a young life, that young life will grow up by the grace of God to be that man or woman of God. It's that age of opportunity that you have. And that's only one season in that life. That one season, you miss it, and that's it. That one season to shape their worldviews, that they will begin to see the world around them with the eyes or the lenses of how God sees. A world that is deprived of the grace of God, a world that is in need of the incarnate Christ. Learn to see that parenting a teen. Acknowledge it's not easy, but you need God's help. There's no such thing as perfection, seriously speaking, right? Parents, there's no such thing as perfection. Why do I say so? It's because we are living under the time of Genesis 3:6. What is the time of Genesis 3:6? Sin is still prevalent in the world today. As it was in the days of Adam and Eve, sin is still the biggest challenge and problems for all of us. We move and we are still living in an age where the people choose to worship the creation rather than the Creator God. Romans 1:25 reminds us, you choose to worship the creations instead of Creator God. The root of problems in our homes and our families is really this sinful, selfish nature of both the children and the adults. It has come from the original sin in the Garden of Eden. It can sometimes be difficult to coexist peacefully, but we ought to strive with God's help to overcome, to raise spiritually healthy children and teenagers who are God-honoring. It is unrealistic to really expect a perfect kid. It is unrealistic to also expect to be a perfect parent. That's why if you tell me today you got no problems, then I say, man, you got problems. You got to ask God to check your heart and where are you at in your parenting. It is what I would call bad theology to say that there are perfect families here today, for we are all in desperate need of a Savior in our lives. More often than not, right, you ask yourself, what is the fundamental reason behind your struggle with the children in their behavior? Actually, it is more of this. Not slapping your face, huh? It's not about Facebook, it's about your face. Bukan Facebook, but muka kamu. It is about our face. Because we live in a culture of shame and honor. Oh, yeah, you would never want people to say, ah, that Mr. Yo, ah, this one, ah, his son, ah, like that one, ah, yeah, yeah. You would never want to hear comments like that. Because why? It's about you, ma, yourself. It's about your own selfishness. You want your children to be that 12A1 SPM holder. Wow. 11A1, 1A2, also cannot. Not good enough. Must 12A1 plus plus. If got plus plus plus, you also want plus plus plus. It's about you, yourself. That selfishness. That same selfishness when Eve and Adam in the Garden of Eden, when the serpent asked them, did God say? No, you never die. Did God say? Wow. All the Adams would say, yeah, law, it's Eve law that caused me to sin law. Hey, but wait a minute, just take a look in that scripture that I just quoted. He says, Adam was with his wife when she took the fruit. Adam was there all along. He was a partner in that same sin. Fourth truth that you must always keep in mind is adolescence is just a stage, a process in their development. You can't run away from that fact. It's part and parcel of their development. The development is an ongoing. You can't expect it to be instant overnight, right? Tonight, I pray. I say, God, dear God, make Timothy, you know, the ideal boy that will be the model that everybody in Sitia 1 would want to model after. Tomorrow morning, I wake up, I look at Timothy. It's still the same, huh? How come, huh? Timothy, how come, huh? You're still the same. It doesn't come overnight. It is a process that they will go through that you need to exercise patience to work with them. As you pray, as you help them to grow, you need to allow the Holy Spirit to work with them. You need to walk with them, work with them, as Paul reminded Titus. Paul reminded Titus in chapter 2, verse 6, where he says that to be a model, you need to model for them. Right? So, fifthly, independence is the goal of adolescence. Ask any teenager today in our midst, right? They would say, yeah, I want to be independent, right? Yeah. Ask them, what's your favorite song? I want to break free. Wow. That's your favorite song. They want to be break free. Free from what? Free from their parents. Free from what? Free from their teachers. Free from the schools or whatever discipline. In God's original design, every human being will go through this progression in their development. You will see that. You know, the growth from child to adulthood eventually becomes an independent adult. Look in Genesis 2, verse 4. Genesis 2, verse 4, will tell you that for this reason, the man will leave his parents and be united with the woman. Eventually, they will become independent on their own. And that is what God says, that this is really part of my design, all right? So these are the fundamental truths that parents, you need to hold and always remind yourself, right? Whenever you feel that the tension, that pressure is building up to the point you're trying to almost crawl up the wall in your home, remember the fundamental truth that the scripture has taught us. So you say, okay, so what about this parenting of these teenagers all about? Well, teenagers always look for ways to be relevant in today's culture. We need to understand that deep in their heart, they also want to be relevant and they want to be respected as such. You know, October 8, 2020, in the midst of our lockdown and the global pandemic, a song was released. And overnight, in just 24 hours, this song had 8 million downloads. Can you imagine in the space of 24 hours? 24 hours, 8 million downloads. What kind of song is it? It was just a song about loneliness, sung by a teenager. Title of the song, Lonely. You say, ayo, what kind of song like that? Lonely, right? A new app called Threads recently, in a space of 24 hours, 30 million subscribers globally. Think about it. How can this not be an opportunity for you as parents? Because the majority of these downloads are teenagers. They are the youths of today. The youth culture of today, the teens, they share a distinct characteristic of authenticity and be real. That's what they look for. They may not tell you, but they, in their heart, they say, we have enough of all these put-ons. We have enough of all this fake that you are putting on before us. The teens looks for connected, meaningful relationships. That's what they want. The culture of today among the youth is they look for authenticity. They look for real. They look for a connected, meaningful relationship. Do you realize that? Do you realize that? So you listen to this. I see some smiles on the face. Must be a very familiar song for you, right?
Lonely, I'm Mr. Lonely. I have nobody for my own. I'm so lonely.
Okay, enough. This is the church, right? 70 years ago, this is a song that some youth finds it reflective of how they feel. 70 years later, today, you have a song, Lonely, released in 24 hours, 8 million downloads, sung by a teenager, a youth. So you tell me, has anything changed? It has not. So before you scream out at your child and says, Why you always lonely, right? You got 8 brothers, sister, ma. Why still lonely? Get into their culture. Understand their mindset, right? Families, you fulfill a vital function as the primary learning and theological communities. Why do I use such big words, all right? Because I can't find simpler words. You, as families, are really the center of learning about life, of learning about God. You want your child to grow up in faith. Your family has to be that place where they will have this engagement in a meaningful and beneficial manner, right? But oftentimes, like I say, that selfishness in us. Parents, do you realize you could be carrying idols in your life? What are the idols? Face saving. What are the possible idols that could be in your life? Well, you want to live your dreams through your children. Because I couldn't be a doctor. So I want my daughter to be a doctor, or I want my son to be a doctor. You know, something about Asian families, you know, and Malaysia's is no exception. When you ask parents, right, you know, what would you want your children to be when they grow up? You know, it's either doctor, accountant, engineers, that's all. If they say they want to be teacher, they say, who teacher? What teacher? Right? Why teacher? Teacher, salary very low, one, you know. If they say they want to be an artist, what artist, you know? Are you just drawing cartoon only? No. Hey, but do you know that today, some of the people who are artists, who draws the cartoons for comic books, right, are actually multimillionaires too. If you're talking about money, but I'm not talking about money today, I'm talking about the fact that you parents, right, needs to understand that it's in the home where the place, the children will need to learn. I call this horizontal parenting. Why? Because it's a focus on the young people's performance, or on the parents' expectation or the parents' reputation. Yeah, of course. You know, I'm the general manager, ma, of my company. So at home, I'm also general manager. In neighborhood, I'm also general manager. So my children must reflect that I'm the general manager. Wow. Horizontal parenting talks only about that self in them. But what does the scripture has to say? Scripture has to say in Luke 9:23 that he said to them all, whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross daily and follow me. Galatians 2:20, I've been crucified with Christ, and I no longer live, but Christ lives in me. The life I now live in the body, I have lived by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself to me. Simple. Straightforward, no beating around the bush. We live a life, surrender to Christ. So it's not about my reputation. It's about that incarnate message. Is it seen in my life? A second how. The old are to be a role model for the young, a case of intergenerational influence and impartation within family and faith community. It's encouraging to note this morning that here in this church, this morning, and I hope that this becomes a regular culture in this church, where you have a youth participating in your morning service, in your weekend celebration, where you have youth or children coming to read the scriptures, you know. So I like to challenge this church, take it one step further. Don't make it multi-generational, make it intergenerational. What do I mean? multinational, and intergenerational. Multigenerational, you have just your category of age grouping. Oh, the senior people, they are called the golden people, right? Oh, the not so senior people, but neither here nor there, they are the middle-aged people. Oh, the young adult, right? Everybody also adult lah. Why want to define young adult and old adult and senior adults, right? Can there be a time where we look beyond this boundary lines of age grouping and says, let us serve the Lord together? That's what Paul wrote in his letter to Titus, says, now teach the old to be models for the young. Now be models and example in your speech, in the way you behave, in the way you serve together, right? So it's not only just the children coming out to read the scriptures occasionally, you can also have the others to come out, and that in every ministry, let there be that interconnectedness and intergenerational participation in the building of this church, in this locality. That when people look at this community of faith right here in this location, beside, they will say, that church beside the Chinese school, that church, I want to be in that church. Why? Because they value me for who I am. It's not that they say, oh, uncle, you 60 years old already, or cannot, or children church, only for those, who are young adult, 20 to 35, you too old, 60, cannot. Well, I got good news for you, right? The one that my oldest volunteer in my children ministry team was 80 years old, right? And I had the honor to conduct her homegoing just before I retired. Now, she didn't return to the Lord because of her involvement in children ministry, okay? Please don't get me wrong, right? It was just because of old age, right? But she was faithful in serving the children every week when we were meeting in person until the very end. What was her role? She does... I give her a chair. She sits at the entrance to the children's hall, right? As the children comes in, the children who are early will know, they were very faithfully lined up before her, and she gives them a star that she pins, she sticks on their chest. To the child, it makes a lot of difference. That sticker that I have from this pawpaw makes a lot of difference. And it, to the pawpaw, it's the highlight of her week. 80 years old. I have another teacher. Up to today, she's still serving. I learned how to teach Sunday school from her. Today, she's in her 70s. She is still teaching in the children's church. So this is what I mean about intergenerational. The old to be role models to the young. So family ought to be a redemptive community. What do I mean by that? A redemptive community is parents are the role model about forgiveness. You be that role model about forgiving others, right? Now, the parents ought to guide them to live a life for a higher purpose in their life. You ask me, what do you mean by a higher purpose? Well, we live a life that is really busy, 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 right? Go to school, come back from school, tuition class, come back from tuition class, extracurricular activities, come back, have their dinner, have their shower, homework, you know, and then before they go to bed, right? And then come weekend, right, early morning, you go for your piano class or your violin class, then you go for your swimming class, then you go for your badminton class, then you go for your whatever other classes for the rest of the day. By the time that day ends, your child is already pumped up. Nothing left. No time for anything else. But what does the scripture have to say about this? is that the scripture says you are to learn to teach and model the word of God before them. You are to teach, you are to talk about God. You are to teach them about that God consciousness, living moment by moment conscious that God is just as interested in you when you're in the classroom. God is just as interested in you when you're having your recess with your friends. God is just as interested in you when you're having your lunch or your dinner. That they learn to cultivate that God consciousness in their lives. And that is our role. Right? In Deuteronomy 6 to 9, it says to teach them, right? That they will begin to learn to see the world around them through the lenses or the eyes of God and not through what the media is telling them, right? It is what God has ordained, right? For them to learn to know Him for who He is, right? And parents, remember this, you and your wife, you are a team. It is not, you and your wife are competitors. You are never in competition with your wife in parenting. You are a team, a tag team. So help your teenagers to learn, right? To learn and understand who they are in the eyes of God. Help them to see their self-esteem and self-worth, right? That their stand before the Lord, right, is what God has created them. And Father, remember, you are the spiritual leader. You are. In Ephesians, it says that do not exasperate your child, right? Sometimes us fathers forget. We have a knack to irritate the child in the most stupid way, right? Because why? We want our way or no way. It's either our way or no way. So fathers, remember, you are the spiritual leader. Oftentimes, you know, my child, when they give me their answers, I realize my fault. I realize my weakness, that moment of weakness, and I will confess and ask them for forgiveness. Right? So, parents, be that model for them. Now, that doesn't mean that you, children, today can go back and tell your parents, see, the preacher today say, you must do this to me, huh? You must treat me well, huh? Don't forget, the word of God is also for you. You are not exempted, right? Because it says, no matter what, you got to learn to honor and respect your parents, so that it may go well with you in the future, in the days to come, in the generations to come. You are not in any way exempted, right? So, fifthly, parents ought to help their teens see their self-worth, like I said. See them as how God approves of them, not of what the world around them approves, right? It is God who created them in this image, just as God has created your parents and you in His image, right? So, parents, learn to model that incarnate life of Christ before your children and for your children, right? You need to establish that respect and build that relationship. You don't disappear for days on end and suddenly reappear in your child's life and say, I'm your father. I tell you do this, you do this. You don't question me. You have not earned that right, other than the fact that you have been a biological parent. Why? Because you have not established that relationship. You have not. You need to work to earn that respect, to build that relationship with them, that you can speak and speak well into their life. Now, parents need to engage with the teens' culture, right? Culture is really a very big area in dealing with your youth, in dealing with your children, right? time does not permit me to go in depth, so I'll just share quickly what you know I've gathered from the scriptures. There is a need, a call for us to be separated from the world and not be in the world. What do I mean, right? In reference to culture, the parent, the people made in God's image are interacting with the world that is a fallen world, a world that has gone wrong, right? A world that God has created perfect initially, but because of sin, it has become a fallen world. And that's the culture that we are dealing with. So Scripture talks about the need to be separated, but yet also the need for us to be engaged, right? Separate from the cultures of the world, but engagement as salt and light in the world, right? John 17:6, Jesus in his prayer says that they are in the world, but they are not of the world. So parents, as you disciple the child, disciple them into a sanctified life, a call to a sanctified life, yeah, a call to a spiritual consecration and redemptive engagement. And that's what we are called to teach these children, right, about spiritual consecration and redemptive engagement with the world. What do I mean by that? Simply means, do you as a parents learn to engage your children in the culture that they are in today, but do not embrace, notice the difference. Engaging with the culture doesn't mean you need to embrace and assimilate totally into their culture. You need to be aware. You need to help them to process and see in the light of the Word of God what is the difference between the world today and the world that God has created. And the Scripture is then that benchmark that you benchmark against. So the big idea again today, carpe diem, seize the day. This is the age of opportunity that you mustn't let go, right? I just want to share briefly, just a life story, how this one of the times in the growing years of a child who's autistic, but nevertheless, just like any other teenagers, right? Yeah. My boy, as he became a teenager, he was very fascinated with the world of computers because the outside world seems to treat him at a distance, right? Because he knew that he was different. So he knows also that the rule of the house is he has only a certain number of hours to work with. So one day, he told my wife he was going out cycling. So my wife said, okay, good, you know, to have some exercise in the evening. Unbeknown to my wife, he had taken the key to the room where we lock up the computer, right? So I came back from work very tired and I was just resting, and suddenly, you know, the Lord shook me and woke me up, you know, and showed me a picture of my boy's bicycle parked in front of a shop at the flats behind where we live. And I woke up, I ran to, the Lord says, you know, get up. Something is about to happen to your son. And I came downstairs, asked my wife, you know, where he see it. And she says, oh, he has gone out cycling. I said, I think I know where. So I took my car, I drove. True enough, when I came to that shop, there was his bicycle parked there. And then I walk into that shop. That shop was the key maker, the locksmith. As I walk in, the locksmith was handing over a set of keys to my son. As he reached out, I said, what are you doing? He got a shock. He looked at me, shocked. I said, what are you doing? He said, and the locksmith said, oh, he came to duplicate the keys. So I said, can I have a look? You know, and then I saw it was the keys to the computer room. And then the locksmith said, so now who's going to pay for the key? I said, he's going to pay, but I'm keeping the keys. So I took him back, I took him home, and I sat him down and asked him why. He says, oh, I don't want to inconvenience you. Each time when I want to use the computer, I got to take the key. I said, besides that, any other reason? You know, and he confessed that he, you know, so that he can sneak down at night and play when we are asleep. You know, you see, teenagers have a way to surprise you. The same. My daughter too, you know. One day I turned on my digital camera and suddenly a pair of eyes just came out on the screen and two black holes between the eyes. I was just wondering, you know, and upon closer look, I realized that she was taking a selfie at that time when you don't have phones yet, you know, using, playing around with a digital camera. So you see, you got aliens in the home, right? But what am I saying this? God is more interested in your child than you ever gave him credit for. And learn to partner with God in raising this child as God's child. So in conclusion, I want to say this. We begin this morning with that soup that we talk about, the other necessary ingredients. There will be times in your parenting of a teenager that will be sweet. There'll be times that it might be sour, spicy, puzzling, but amidst it all, it's never complete if some are missing. Learn to raise a Eutychus for God. Just imagine Eutychus brought back to life. How would it have impacted his life? Learn to raise a child that will be hungry for the Word of God. Learn to raise a child that will be all for God. For Scriptures teaches us this, that this generation that you are raising is a generation that will be a kingdom generation for him. Church, note this, carpe diem. Don't miss out on this age and time of opportunity. God gave us children as gifts to be steward of, to raise them up in the fear of him. That's that one season in their life that we can make a difference to help them see and to help them grow. So seize this opportunity, church, and never let go until God says it is done. This is what the life of your child is, a blank sheet for you to write in that message of God's love in them. I'd like to invite Ben up here to lead us in this closing song. Amidst your struggle, your frustrations, parents, note this one thing. God is never leaving you alone. In your parenting, God wants to be even more involved than you ever think. Nothing that both me and my wife have ever done for our children could ever been achieved or done if it is not through Christ. It is through Christ. We give glory to him. Today, my son is gainfully employed and he still serves in whatever capacity with his gift of music. Just the other day, he was telling us about, you know, all these weeks that he disappeared on Friday nights, or Friday evenings after work, to go down to the city to help train a group of blind people that they could perform at an arts festival next weekend. And says, you know, initially, he says, I don't know how to teach blind people to play music in a meaningful way. But along the way, I found it so fulfilling. And guess what? He says, Mommy, Daddy, I learned to appreciate the gift of sight. I learned to appreciate them as God's creation as well.
Church, shall we rise as you sing the closing song? Yet not I, but through Christ in me.
Jesus, my Redeemer.
Yes, God, whatever we do, O God, Lord, as we stand in your midst, may we stand, O God, in gratitude to say, yet not I, but it is Christ who works through me. Teach us, O God, to walk in your ways. Teach us, O God, to live that incarnate life where Christ is the Lordship of our life. Teach us, O God, to walk with our children as Christ walks with us. As your Spirit, O Lord, give us strength to overcome. As your Spirit, O God, grant us that armor of yours against the arrows of the enemy. May we be found faithful to walk with our children in the fear of you. May we be found faithful to walk with them, to raise them up, as your kingdom generation. That, Lord, we shall walk together, generations with generations, generations to generations to come. That, God, we can proudly say, it's not I, but Christ who works through me. That Christ is not only with us, but Christ is in us, and Christ continues to work through us in every moment, in every day, in every situation. God, we surrender each and every one of us. Everything that we have is all yours. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Let us receive the benediction. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all from this time forth and forevermore. Amen. Church, we thank Brother Jonathan for the ministry of the word, and our service is now over. Thank you for joining us. God bless you and have a blessed week ahead.